I've got enough memory on my phone. Okay. Charity. Charitable contributions can come in a couple of different forms, cash or non-cash. Non-cash encompasses lots of different things. Cash is cash, right? I mean, cash is actual cash or it's a check. Credit card would count if you charged donations onto a credit card. That would count as cash. There are particular rules for cash donations and for non-cash donations, and a lot of them depend upon how much you are actually donating. First off, who can you give a donation to? Not to just anybody. So if you see somebody standing on the street corner who has a sign up and you decide to give them some money, that's awfully nice of you. That is not a charitable contribution. The receiving entity has to be one of these types of charities. So, government unit or subdivision of the U.S. or its possessions, as long as the gift is for exclusively public purposes. So, for example, if somebody gave a gift to, a local government would be a subdivision, maybe a city, in order to put up a statue, something like that, or some sort of piece of art, right? That would count. The gift is exclusively for public purposes, right? It's not for operations. It's for public purposes. The one that's highlighted is probably the most common type of charitable organization, known as a 501c3. I don't know if any of you have heard that before. I'm sure Jose has heard it before. 501c3 refers to a particular type of organization. It's referring to the tax code section where it's described. 501c3. Nonprofit organization organized and operated exclusively for religious, charitable, scientific, literary, or educational purposes, or to foster international amateur sports competition, think Olympics, and is not disqualified from tax-exempt status under IRC 501c3. Organizations that are 501c3 will state such on their website, on their letterhead. There's also a search engine on the IRS website where you can look up organizations to see if they are actually one of these qualifying organizations. Another type, post or organization of war veterans. As long as no part of the earnings benefits any private shareholder or individual. Think VFW, any other type of veterans organization. Domestic fraternal society or association that uses contributions only for religious, charitable, scientific, or educational purposes. Think Lions clubs, Masonic clubs, I guess they're not clubs, temples, PEO, Rotary, those types of things. A cemetery company, a cemetery company owned and operated exclusively for the benefit of its members. I can't think of an example for that one. Would you really think it's a benefit? I mean, that word benefit is used kind of loosely when you're talking about a cemetery.
That's so specific.
Yeah, it's very specific. Some of these are kind of funny, aren't they? So there is this search engine on the IRS website that you can go to look up organizations. So, and you can also, you can look at their tax returns. Nonprofit organizations, even though they don't generally pay any federal income tax, they still have to file a tax return. Okay, so those, and that's public information. So they have to submit those, and then the IRS puts them online as well, so everybody can see how much of their collections and their donations actually go toward their charitable purpose, how much are actually going toward administrative salaries and all that kind of stuff. So there's the search tool. So So if you had any question about whether or not the organization you're donating to is a charitable organization for purposes of the deduction, you could look on there. All right, so in order to be deductible, it has to be in cash or some other property of value. Deductions, there is no deductions for services. So you cannot donate your time and then put a value on your time and then take a tax donation on that amount. So for example, if you volunteer at the soup kitchen 5 hours a week and you value your time at $20 an hour plus $100 a week, you can't take a deduction for $5,200 because you never actually received the money. If you were paid a salary of $5,200 and then you turned around and donated $5,200 to the organization, then you could deduct that $5,200 because you're paying tax on the $5,200 when you receive it as a salary. But you never received the income in the first place when you're donating your time. So time is not deductible. So that's what they mean when they say it has to be cash or some other property of value. They've got an example here. Kathy, local CPA, supporter of Boys and Girls Club. So she compiles their monthly financial statements for them for no charge. She also prepares their tax return every year for no charge. She estimates she spends 20 hours a year working on stuff for the Boys and Girls Club. Normal hourly rate is $100 an hour, but because it's her services, she cannot deduct it. Now, she could deduct the cost of paper that she uses to print out the monthly statements and if she pays for the postage to send in postage with their for tax returns anymore. Not many people send them in by paper. It would be e-file. If she paid an e-file fee for filing the tax return, she could deduct that, but the actual cost of her time is not deductible. Transportation expenses would be deductible. So if she had any sort of transportation expenses, maybe she goes to the meetings once a month to report on the monthly financials, and she presents those monthly financials to the club, then her transportation to and from would be considered deductible because she's out of pocket for that transportation, right? You can take actual expenses or a per mile rate. Just like with the military moving expenses, medical expenses, we also had a per mile rate. We've got a per mile rate for charity as well. This time it's 14 cents a mile. I think it was 16 cents a mile for medical, and maybe 19 cents a mile for the military moving expense. They have a different rate for each purpose. So don't ask me why. If she drives 100 miles a month for the Boys and Girls Club on their behalf, then she would get to deduct $14 for every month times 12. That would be her deduction for that. All right. So, like I said, it's got to be cash or some other property of value. Now, we make a distinction. So, this is, cash is fairly easy. Cash is cash. But when it's property, it gets a little bit sticky. Because we got to value that property. And it depends on the type of property that we donate. We make this distinction between what's called ordinary income property and capital property. Property. Capital property are things like investments. If you sold it, it would generate capital income, which is special tax rates happen to be the same as those dividend rates that we worked with. Ordinary income property is property that if you sold it, it would generate ordinary income. Generally speaking, inventory and accounts receivable would be included in that. So that just means it's going to be taxed at ordinary tax rates. Those original tax rates that we looked at in chapter 2. So sometimes we can donate capital property or we can donate ordinary income property. Generally speaking, and we're talking property here, not cash, because cash is cash, right? So capital gain property in general, and this is property that you either own it personally. Your personal car is capital property, by the way, considered to be capital property, or you have it for investment purposes. We're going to go into a lot more detail on ordinary and capital property in chapter 7. But if you donate capital property to a public charity, the deductible donation is the amount of the property's fair market value. In general, that's a great deal. If you are donating something that has appreciated in value, think stocks, what you're doing is, so let me give you two scenarios. Say you've got some Microsoft stock. What's Microsoft trading at today? Somebody look up what Microsoft's trading. I probably don't want to know, but. Who wants to look it up?
$235.
Well, it's not as bad as I thought. Okay, so Microsoft is at $235 a share. That's today. Today is 9/29/22. All right, so let's say I've got 10 shares of Microsoft. What's my total fair market value as of today? $23.50, right? But I bought that Microsoft stock back in, let's say I bought it like back in 1997. What was it trading at in 1997? Just an average. Let's say January 1st, 1997. So this is our fair market value. This is when I bought it. What was it trading at then? Can you find it? Yahoo Finance probably has it. A historical.
$11?
Yes, $11. And I only bought 10 shares. I should have bought more. All right, so its basis is $110, right? That's what I paid for it back in 1997. If I sold that Microsoft stock right now, all 10 shares of it, I would have a gain, obviously, right? So I would have a gain of, let's see, 22.40. I'd have to pay tax on that. I get some special tax rates. It's long-term capital gain. I get some those qualified dividend tax rates, but I still am going to have to pay tax on it, right? And then I turn around and I donate it. I donate the cash, right? So there would be two parts to this. I would get a taxable gain, but a deduction. So donation. And remember, it depending upon whether I even qualify for the itemized deductions, right? And then I have a donation of that cash of $22.40. Okay. There are actually some tax benefits to this because the tax rate for the gain is lower. This donation would offset ordinary income, which has a higher tax rate. But still, I'd have to declare this income and pay tax on it, and then I would get the donation deduction. However, I can skip this part. If I just donate the shares directly to the organization, I say, here's my Microsoft shares. I get to deduct the fair market value, the $23.50. I don't have to declare the gain. So I get the deduction without having to have the gain. It's a pretty good deal. It's a good deal for the organization because they're receiving 10 shares of Microsoft. And it's a good deal for the taxpayer because then they don't have to worry about this gain part. Okay? So it's a special kind of special treatment. You don't see that very often in the tax code, where you're getting all the benefit and really none of the downside. Usually they balance benefit with downside, but in this case they don't. Now, that's for capital property. Ordinary property, we'll talk about ordinary property down here somewhere. Ordinary property, where is it? When ordinary income property, such as inventory or accounts receivable, is donated, the deduction amount is limited to the tax basis of the property donated. So whatever you paid for it, right? So we'll imagine for a minute that our Microsoft stock is ordinary property. It's not, but we'll just pretend. Then we would be limited. Our donation amount would be the $110, what our basis is in that. Now, that's what about personal tangible property? We're talking here, what is personal tangible property, first off? So, personal property is anything that's not real property. Real property is real estate. So, a computer, a car, a desk, something that's you know, it, that type of property. And personal means it's owned personally, it's not owned by a business, right? It's personal, tangible property. So if it's tangible personal property, the treatment depends upon whether the property is put to a use by the charity that is related or unrelated to its tax-exempt status. Most commonly, we run into this when people donate cars. The difference between whether the organization ends up using the car for their exempt status or if they end up just selling the car and taking the cash. Okay, there's a difference then in the donation amount. And what happens is organizations that take tangible personal property like that, they will, they'll let you know. They'll give you information on how they used it, whether they sold it, or whether they used it in their organization. So if it was donated and put to a use that is related, I'm sorry, that's unrelated to the purpose, so it's sold, essentially the contribution is no longer the fair market value. It's reduced by any amount of long-term capital gain that would have been realized if the property had been sold at its fair market value. So essentially, it's the cost basis of the property. If it's, so when you donate a car to an organization, if they just turn around and sell it, then your donation amount is whatever you paid for it, essentially, your basis in the property, okay, minus any adjustment. So it, so the amount of any would be reduced. I'm sorry, it's not necessarily that, because if the fair market value is lower than that, you would use the fair market value. So an example here, they've got the sculptures donated to a museum and it's put on display. That's a related use, right? That would be a related purpose. If the museum had sold the sculpture without displaying it, used the funds for operations, that would be an unrelated use, okay? And would require a different treatment. So let's look at this example. Kemba donated his old computer to Helping Hands Industries. He had purchased it for personal use several years ago. It cost him $1,500. Computer's fair market value at the date of donation was $400. It is a capital asset held for more than 1 year, so he can deduct the $400 fair market value as a charitable contribution. So already mentioned this about ordinary income property. So it depends on what the charity is going to use it for. Now, another limitation is there are different types of donations have different AGI limits. Meaning, some of these items, you can't donate 100% of what your AGI is. it's some lower percentage. The only items that you can donate and get 100% of AGI donation value are cash contributions made directly to a charitable organization. So my AGI is $100,000 and I give $100,000 of cash to United Way. That is I get a deduction for all of that $100,000 because it was in cash. Now, sometimes if you had a contribution, if I had made a contribution of $150,000, now that's over my AGI, I carry forward the $50,000 excess for up to 5 years. Okay? A contribution in excess of limitation carried forward for the next 5 years. However, when it's carried forward, there is a 60% limitation in future years. Let's see. There's also, so you do get these days a below the line deduction because it's below adjusted gross income, but it's directly on the form 1040. This is something that just came about in the last couple of years. If you donated cash, it's got to be cash, can't be like non-cash, like donating, you know, dropping stuff off at Goodwill, that sort of thing. Cash donations of up to $300 per person or per taxpayer, so $600 for married filing jointly, you can deduct it. You don't have to itemize your deductions. Now, if you do itemize your deductions and you put the $600 on the front of the return, you have to make sure not to put it on that $600 on Schedule A. That would be double dipping. That's not allowed. Let's see here. Okay, we're going to go through this example of Doris. This kind of shows you the different scenarios between whether it's a cash donation, the treatment, if it's a cash donation, if it's a non-cash donation that's used for a related use, if it's a non-cash donation that's used for an unrelated use. Just gives you an illustration of the differences there. So, we've got Doris. She's a wealthy widow. Her AGI is $200,000 from investments. She makes a $150,000 cash donation to State University. Her charitable deduction is the entire $150,000. State University is an eligible organization, and it's a cash donation, so she gets 100% of that. Now, assume the same facts. However, instead of giving cash of $150,000, she contributes a vacation cottage she's owned for many years. The cottage, which is in a marshland and could be used for research purposes, has a fair market value of $150,000. Same value, $150,000. University uses the cottage as a research station, so that's a related use, right? In this case, her deduction is going to be limited to $60,000. This has, and it's related to this particular limitation up here. There's a 30% limitation, limited to 30% of AGI, not the donation amount, but 30% of AGI. Applies to contributions of long-term tangible capital gain property. When long-term tangible capital gain property is contributed to a public charity, and the property is put to a related use, the taxpayer can take a deduction for the fair market value, but it is limited to 30% of the taxpayer's adjusted gross income. So there's that AGI limit. So that's what happened here in this second scenario. It was tangible capital gain property, personal property to her, but it's considered to be tangible capital gain property. It was contributed to a public charity, and it was put to a related use. Her AGI is $200,000, so she's limited to $30,000. The other $90,000 of her contribution amount gets carried forward for the next 5 years. So hopefully she's going to have enough AGI to take that. All right, now she does have a choice, though. What she could do is elect to reduce the fair market, but treat it as though it was, treat it as though it was for an unrelated use. So if she elects, she could then elect to reduce the fair market value of the property by the amount of long-term capital gain that would have been recognized if it had been sold at the fair market value. Then it's the 60% limitation rather than the 30% limitation. Okay, why in the world would she do that? I'll show you why she might do that. So same facts. However, Doris elects to reduce the fair market value of the cottage by the amount of the long-term capital gain that she would have recognized if she had sold it. Her adjusted basis in the cottage is $70,000. Her charitable contribution, therefore, would be $70,000, whereas up here, it was $60,000. So now it's $70,000, and she can take all of it because 60% of her AGI of $200,000 is $120,000. So she gets an extra $10,000 donation. Now the bad part is she has no carry forward at that point. So that $90,000 extra is gone. Now, she might do that if, you know, maybe she's at the end of her life. Maybe she doesn't anticipate having much adjusted gross income in the next several years. There may be reasons that she chooses to do that, forego that extra $90,000 in future years to take the extra $10,000 this year. Another exception is a long-term capital gain, donation of long-term capital gain property, when the charity uses it for unrelated purposes. So same facts, except the university promptly sells the cottage. In this case, the deduction is limited to her basis of $70,000 and subject to the 60% of AGI rule. So it's the same scenario as up here, or same result is up here, but up here Doris has chosen to treat it like this. Down here the university has sold the property. So Doris doesn't really have a choice but to treat it like that. Let's see. 30% limitation also applies to any contribution to charities that are not 100% limitation charities. So war veterans organizations, fraternal orders, cemetery companies, and private foundations. There's also a 20% limitation. This is, again, 20% of AGI. Not the actual contribution. Refers to donation of capital gain property to a private foundation. Deduction for cash is limited to 30%, capital gain property given to the same organization, 20%. Right. Let's see, what else do I want? Oh, you can't, if you receive anything in exchange, you have to reduce the amount of the donation by what you received. Also, you can no longer make contributions to colleges if the taxpayer receives any type of preferential benefit. I would see this a lot. So, I mean, living in Ames and working at Ames, we get a lot of individuals who support Iowa State. A lot of season ticket holders for basketball games and football games and that sort of thing. A lot of professors and stuff. Iowa State, and Iowa did this too. If you donate $10,000, then they give you essentially season tickets. So season tickets are really hard to come by, especially to, well, they were to the basketball games. But they would give, so you'd get season tickets in exchange for this donation. Well, and it used to be that they could the $10,000 would be a deductible donation for the individual who made it, minus the value of the tickets, right? So you'd have to subtract the value of the tickets. Well, now, none of that $10,000 is deductible anymore. So I'm sure that a lot of those donations probably fizzled out. Not all of them, but, or they found some other way around it. Documentation. So there are documentation requirements for all of this. If you give a gift to a charitable organization in cash that is less than $250, you essentially need like a copy of a canceled check or some sort of receipt. So if you're putting money in the collection plate at church every week and you're just putting cash in, you can't deduct that if you don't have some sort of receipt for it. Okay, so you do have to have some sort of receipt. The $250 is for each individual, that limit is for each individual donation, not in aggregate. So individual donations under $250, you need a canceled check, some sort of a written record to substantiate it. If it's more than $250, you need to get a written acknowledgement from the organization. And they send these out now in regular course. They do this, the organizations do this, have this in their systems to do this. It has to indicate the date, the amount of the contribution, whether the taxpayer received anything in exchange, description and good faith estimate of the value of the goods that were received. In this case, if it's more than 250, and this is a single donation, more than 250, then the canceled check alone is not enough. You gotta have more than a copy of a canceled check. Do people write checks anymore?
I don't remember. I can't remember the one.
For rent. For rent, yeah.
Oh,
you can Venmo that, can't you?
Yeah, you can do it online, but sometimes, you know, technology doesn't work.
All right. Let's see. Is there anything else? So you will have, as part of your software, your Shoebox to Software problem, your TaxAct problem this week, you will have some charitable contributions. This is the form that you would use, the 8283. So let me show you how this would work. It is, the door is closed. Okay, so this is the parts that you're gonna fill out is, I think just this first part. So they donated cash, so cash of $1,000 with no individual contribution greater than $250. We're going to assume that they do have the canceled checks. A painting with a fair market value of $750, basis is $500. Three large bags of used clothing. Charitable contribution would look like this, $1,000, so that $1,000 would just go on the Schedule A. This first line here, 1,000. But for the other items, other than by cash or check, if you made any gift of 250 or more, see instructions, you must attach 8283 if the total is over $500. Well, their total is over $500. So they have a painting, fair market value of $750, which they would put on here. So I don't know what organization they don't need to. Say. Okay. What's they doing there?
Oops. Yeah, to our church.
To their church?
Yeah.
Okay. Description, painting, new, whatever. And then down here, line A continues down here. Date of the contribution, I don't know if it says one. Date acquired, I don't know. How acquired, purchase, cost, donor's cost or adjusted basis, $500, fair market value, $750. This would be maybe comparable sales. It'll probably give you a drop down for some of those. That's the $750. And then we have the close as well. Goodwill, probably use our church. Clothing, used. We'll say the same thing here. And then various, lots of clothing. Outcry purchase. Do they have a basis here for the clothes? Mm-hmm.
this $950 gets transferred over to the Schedule A. No carryover.
Total empty.
So that's what that would be. Questions?
So say you're giving money from like a Drake organization, the Drake organization is coming from the United Way, do we get any deduction?
So if you're giving money to whoever you gave the money directly to.
So it's not credits for the account.
I'm sorry?
It's not credits. Credits for the account on the other side.
The soft credits, is that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
That would be, actually they would have to report, because they're both nonprofit organizations, they would report that on their 990. But I don't know what you mean by soft credits, I guess. Is it just between nonprofit?
Yeah, so it would be like the Drake organization would be a soft credit if whoever was donating as like a hard credit.
Okay.
So primary credit.
Okay. It would be whoever you actually donated. I mean, if ultimately United Way is going to be getting it, that's kind of a transfer between those two organizations rather than a donation from the taxpayer. All right. Any other questions? All right, hang in there. We're almost done. We've got 15 minutes of your time left. This one is pretty, this one's pretty timely, actually. Deductible casualty and theft losses. So, what's a casualty? We had a big casualty, and they're currently having a big casualty down in Florida, now in South Carolina, apparently, with the hurricane. It's kind of funny, though, when you look at the definition. Oh, let me do something first. Stop and start this.